family, and welcome. 300 years have not gone by since the Savior died, and the enemy of God is trying once again to destroy His church. As we look at the close of the 20th century and all we've lived through, I know there is a God, and He is a patient and loving, merciful God. But I wonder how much more He's going to take. When He looks at those whom He has chosen, betraying Him and His church, I sit and ponder, is this it, Lord? Have you had it, Lord? When even good people are compromising their church and their Pope because of self-interest, I have to ask, doesn't anyone believe in heaven with its reward and hell with its damnation? Saying there is no place as heaven, hell, or purgatory does not change the fact that there is a heaven, hell, and purgatory. And we will all be judged and rewarded in one way or the other.
What price earthly glory? I sometimes think, when we are facing the ceiling, knowing the next face we will see is that of Jesus, have all the temporary accolades, laurels, recognition, and praise been worth it? When He holds out His pierced hands, His dear head with a crown of thorns pressed against His skull, blood pouring out of His wounds, His heart bleeding and sorrowful, will we cry out, Lord, was it worth it? You died for a miserable sinner like me, and I betrayed You. I sold You out like that other trusted apostle, Judas. And then, with no more time to grieve, to sorrow for our transgressions against Him in His church, He reaches out, and we know we must go.
One day I telephoned a priest who was a very good friend of ours and said, Father, will you hear my confession? As he was over 1,000 miles away, he knew I was just being facetious and answered with a question, what's happening now? Now, this was before we had done any research on the many heresies that have attacked our church over our 2,000-year history. I was upset and a little more than concerned with things that I had seen and heard transpiring in some of our churches. A highly respected historian, he consoled me with, don't get excited. This has been going on for 2,000 years and we're still here. Mm. Jesus made a promise that hell would not prevail against His church, and He will not go back on that promise, no matter how much we try to antagonize Him.
The heresy we're going to speak on now is that of the Novatians. Here we are. We're in Rome. It's around the year 250 AD. The church has barely had rest from the former heresies, and she's under attack once again. It is coming from within. We find the priest, Novatian, or Novatus, as he is also known, who is so highly respected by the entire Roman clergy, he is chosen to represent his fellow Roman priests. He will not only go against his church, he will set himself up as an anti-pope.
Novatian, like so many others of the early church, had not been baptized as a baby, but was waiting until he was on his deathbed. He and the people of his day felt that in this way they could live a life of sin, be baptized at the point of death, and die without sin on their souls. This was and is totally against the teachings of the church. One day, Novatian was dying and a priest was called in to administer the sacrament of baptism. But instead of dying, he recovered, and when he did, he never received any of the other sacraments of the church that are essential to be fully a part of the church. He was never confirmed by a bishop.
It boggles the mind how he ever became a priest without having first received the sacraments of penance, Holy Communion, and confirmation. Without the gifts of the Holy Spirit and the strength derived from the sacraments, it is understandable how he could have fallen into prideful error. Instead of being joyful and thanking God for having given him gifts of intellect and the charisma to powerfully proclaim the truths of the church, he often appeared moody and despondent. His bishop, St. Cyprian, said Novatian tended to become easily agitated. He was arbitrarily rebellious and was obsessed with an insatiable appetite for glory and self-praise.
Now, at this time, there was a great persecution going on under Emperor Decius. Many Christians apostatized in order to avoid being part of the bloodbath. When the persecution slackened, many apostates wanted to return to the church. This caused a great deal of bitterness among those who had stayed faithful to the church and often suffered persecution. A heated debate arose as to whether the apostates should be accepted back in the church. Novatian joined dissenters who believed Bishop St. Cyprian should accept those wishing to return to the church back at once with little or no penance.
To be a Christian in the early days of the church was to be almost assured a martyr's death. Pope St. Fabian was one of the first victims of the horrible persecution brought about by Emperor Decius. The Pope was arrested and was among the first to be martyred for his faith. The clergy postponed voting for a successor because some of their number was still in jail. And those that were in jail, of course, were needed to vote. The bishops ran the church for 14 months with Novation as their spokesman. When all the bishops finally convened to vote, Novation fully expected to be elected pope.
Now, imagine his bitterness when Bishop St. Cyprian instead nominated Cornelius, a very humble priest who had always been grateful to serve the church in any capacity, no matter how small. In March 251 AD, St. Cornelius was elected pope and remained vicar of Christ until the year 253. Novation contested the bishop's decision and had himself declared a bishop, as no one would ordain the disobedient priest bishop. It's believed he founded three Italian bishops to do it. Because their dioceses were located in a very remote part of Italy, the bishops had not heard of his defiance of the pope. When he befriended them, they were completely unaware of his devious plan. He wined and dined them. He kept pouring wine until they were intoxicated to the point of stupefaction. He covertly had them consecrate him a bishop.
Now, when Fabian had been pope, he had ordained Novation to the priesthood. Holding him in high regard, he made Novation a member of the College of Presbyters, a group who advises the bishop, and then chose him to represent them. When St. Cornelius became pope, he questioned Novation's priesthood, claiming he had been uncanonically ordained, despite the strong opposition of clergy and laity. He said Novation was possessed by Lucifer for a period of time, most likely when he was a catechumen.
Now, whereas Novation had disagreed with St. Cyprian, arguing he had not shown enough clemency to those who had fallen away from the church, now he attacked Pope St. Cornelius with a severe religiosity, devoid of all compassion towards those who desired to return. This was called the heresy of rigorism. Novation had attacked St. Cyprian for not being lenient enough, and now he was attacking Pope Cornelius for being too lenient.
He disagreed with Pope Cornelius, who wanted to accept them back after they had done appropriate penance. Novation would not accept them back under any conditions. He wrote to all the bishops stating his case against the pope. His arguments were brilliant, as he was highly proficient in letter writing. He believed if he could win support against St. Cornelius on this matter, he could sway the bishops to elect him pope. Mm-hmm. Although at first it appeared Novation would have some followers, among the presbyters at the end, they all rallied around the pope, St. Cornelius. Novation was condemned.
Novation set himself up as an anti-pope. He left the church, causing a schism. He modeled his new church after the official church. But that was where it stopped. Although he claimed to be orthodox, his teachings were contrary to the magisterium. Before he became ambitious and broke with the church because he wanted to be pope, Novation's writings were brilliant and right on target with the teachings of the church. One in particular, his treatise on the Holy Trinity, written in 235 AD, is considered the first great theological work to come out of Rome. Most of the writings of the early fathers of the church had heretofore come from the East. As with many of us, when we are recognized for our talents, we forget it is ours only by the grace of God. Nothing we have reason to brag about, as St. Paul tells us in Holy Scripture.
In 251 AD, a council of 60 bishops was called by Pope Cornelius, whereupon Novation was excommunicated. Novation reigned as anti-pope from 251 AD until he died in 258 AD. But the schism he brought about did not die with him, but spread to Spain and Syria. It was to strongly remain and influence the Church of Syria for several centuries. The cause of the Novation schism was not so much differences in the faith, but in the rigoristic attitudes toward those who had either left the church and returned or had lapsed from the faith. in some way, they had repented and...
But as with other heresies, they took a very hard, unloving approach to second marriages, forbidding them under any circumstances. Jesus' church was never, being the great mother she is, wanted anything but that her family be united. And when there have been extenuating circumstances which invalidate the marriage, Mother Church has always responded with love and charity. Another of Novatian's heresy was that no man was to be forgiven a sin after baptism. This may be part of the reasons catechumens did not want to be baptized until the point of death. St. Augustine would in the 4th century fight this heresy, but the Novatian heresy would last in parts of the world until the 5th century.
The enemy of God was really out to destroy the church, and how better than from within? We are still in the 3rd century, and we have another heresy, that of the Manichaeans. Here we will see how dissent unleashed has no respect for borders, but invades ruthlessly, destroying everyone and everything in its wake. The Manichaean heresy was named after Manes, a heretic born in Babylon around 216 AD. Manes, or Mani, was a Persian. When he was 28 years old, he tried to teach religion to his fellow villagers of Maduinu. They remembered when he had been born there. They had watched him grow up. And now he was setting himself up as a teacher. They did not accept him.
He wandered aimlessly for 40 years, proclaiming he was the messenger of the true God, and to Christians that he was the Paraclete, the Holy Spirit, whom Jesus promised he would send. Evidently not making an impact in his travels, he returned to Persia. He manipulated King Orzmud I into believing he was all that he claimed. But as the saying goes, all good things come to an end, or as in this case, all bad things. His time of glory was short-lived. King Osmud I occupied the throne for only 1 year, and with the new king came persecution for Mani. In about the year 276 or 277, the new ruler Bahram had Mani crucified. Bahram then hunted down Mani's followers and mercilessly persecuted them.
The Manichaean heresy was based on two principles of good and evil, darkness and light. Darkness being matter and body, that which is evil, and light being spirit and soul, that which is good. They claimed Satan is no less eternal than God. Rather, he is God's rival. Imagine them proposing God's imitator was his equal. They did not believe that the devil was first a good angel created by God, and that his nature was the work of God. They claimed that the devil came forth from the darkness and was not created by God the Creator. They taught that the devil was himself the beginning and the essence of evil. They believed that the devil formed the human body, and that a child is formed in its mother's womb by the devil. And because of these errors, they did not believe in the resurrection of the body. They said that all flesh was created by fallen angels, not created by God. They espoused our world is divided between good and evil, and our very nature is the battlefield between good and evil, between God and Satan.
One of the most deadly conclusions one would draw from this false philosophy is, since we are not responsible for this conflict within us, we are powerless to control or change it. Then do we have free will? Therefore, is there a chance of conversion or change of heart? This would be dredged up again and again in predestination heresies that surface throughout the history of the church, only to crop up in the 16th century and create a split from which the faithful have still not recovered.
The Manichaean heresy rejected the Old Testament completely and only kept that part of the New Testament which had been dissected, reworded, and redesigned by Mani to suit his own brand of heresy. The Manichaeans also taught that there were two gods, the evil punishing God of the Old Testament and the good God of the New Testament. Again, we find Satan repeating the same old tired lies. The only problem throughout the history of the church is that the unsuspecting faithful have not known that these lies were dispensed with centuries before.
Another tired old heresy which the Manichaeans advocated was that Christ had no body, that he was pure spirit. With that, they denied the incarnation, the birth of the God-man Jesus to the Virgin Mary, spreading his malignancy, wanting to kill all our defense systems. Mani did away with the sacrament of baptism and of matrimony. Some of the heresies promoted by the Manichaeans may sound familiar. For example, they believe that human souls as well as angels are composed of the substance of God. That is being peddled today under the deceptive banner of New Age. His followers believed in reincarnation. So do those who espouse New Age.
And again, the copycat brings up another tired error, that man has two souls, one good and one evil. The Manichaeans stated human souls had previously sinned in heaven, and because of this, the human bodies were cast down on earth. Now, we in the Catholic Church believe that souls in heaven have been cleansed by the blood of the Lamb and are sinless. They have chosen God, and their sanctity is eternal. It's final, just like the punishment of hell is final for those who reject God.
Something the Manichaeans believed in very suspiciously, sounding like the feminist goddess approach to creation spirituality today, was that man was cut of the Father through the Mother of Life. And as Christians, we believe that only God gives us life and that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. Mother Mary herself would tell you that she has no power, but that all life is through God alone.
The Church fights back. Manichaeanism would resurface only with a disguise to be disproved and condemned once again. In the 4th century, when responding to the errors of the Arians, St. Athanasius concluded that the heresies of Arianism could be traced back to Manichaeanism, and not only to Mani and Manichaeanism, but to those heresies of Valentine and Martian, which we spoke of in the 2nd century. In answer to these heresies of St. Athanasius wrote conclusively that we do not worship a creature.
St. Athanasius wrote, "For such an error belongs to heathens and Arians. Rather, we worship the Lord of creation, the incarnate Word of God. For if the flesh, too, is in itself a part of the created world, still it had to become God's body. Nor indeed, the body being such, do we divide it from the Word and adore it by itself. Neither, when we wish to worship the Word, do we separate him from the flesh. Rather, as we said before, knowing that the Word was made flesh, we recognize him as God even after he has come in the flesh. As with all of Lucifer's persistent evil, Manichaeanism would be revived in 13th century France under a new name, Albigensianism, which we will study in a later chapter.
As we repeat over and over again, when the Church is under attack, God raises up a saint or two. What makes one man with a potential for holiness become a heretic and another headed toward a life of sin become a saint? The saint we will now talk about once espoused the heresy of Manichaeanism and would spend the rest of his life correcting the very errors he had once promulgated. Saint Augustine was born into a time of schism and heresy.
On the 13th of November, 354 AD, a child was born to a pagan father, Patricius, and a Christian mother, Monica, in Tagaste, North Africa. His pride not allowing him to walk in the simple truth, Augustine was to grope through the darkness for answers to questions he did not know. In his chase, he embraced one of the more deadly heresies, that of the Manichaeans. He was not to find his way out of that black hole for 9 years.
Monica prayed and cried while her son tried to sway her in his direction. How heavy was Monica's cross as she saw her son not even attending church with her? She stood by helplessly for the next 9 years as he became swallowed up by the false teachings and promises of that dangerous sect of the Manichaeans. I am sure it took all the faith she had to believe he would come back and more to live that belief, and so she prayed.
Augustine's pride kept blocking him from admitting his mother was right. With the Manichaean sect, he could have his cake and eat it too. They assured him he could lead a life of sin, yet still be saved through the merits of those elect who lived a life of abstinence and total chastity. In addition to the power of his mother's 30 years of prayer, an instrument God used to save Augustine's soul was his thirst for the truth. What the Manichaeans taught him no longer satisfied him. He was having a problem with their evasiveness as he dug deeper, searching for answers. Augustine had been so in love with the beauty of the word, he had not gone beyond the meaning behind the word. Augustine, having doubted God, now doubted man. His friends, the Manichaeans, and his newfound friends, the academics, had betrayed him. Their talking in circles tired him. Their worldly attempts to explain the unexplainable did not satisfy the gnawing question inside of him. St. Augustine started to read Holy Scripture. There he found the power of the writings of God in the writings of St. Paul.
A man, another saint you will be hearing about in our program on Arianism, St. Ambrose, would be the instrument through which St. Augustine would finally come back to the church of his mother, the one true church, the Catholic Church. As St. Augustine caused so many to follow this heresy, he would spend the rest of his life defending the Catholic faith and the faithful of that faith against this and other heresies. Dear St. Augustine and St. Monica, the battle rages on as mothers faithfully follow the faith of their fathers and their children, like St. Augustine the sinner refused to become saints. But we all stand on the promise made to St. Monica that God could not resist a mother's tears. Her prayers would be answered, and they were. And ours, dear mothers, will be too.
From the beginning of the second century right up to the fifth century, the church was busily engaged in battling Christological heresies that were either denying the nature of Jesus, the man, or his divinity as Christ, the second person in the Holy Trinity, or Trinitarian errors about the Holy Trinity and the equality of each of the three persons in the one God. Forms of Manichaeanism kept surfacing in Mother Church like festering abscesses. Manichaeanism had spread through Africa to Spain, using the early writings of St. Augustine before he converted to the Catholic faith.
Imagine St. Augustine's broken heart as he saw men of guile using what he had unwittingly espoused. St. Augustine not only corrected these errors, but battled heretics and heresies that threatened his church the rest of his life. His writings attacking not only the Manichaeans, but the Arians, the Donatists, the Pelagians, and others, which we'll cover in subsequent programs. As he wrote in defense of the church, he gave us invaluable teachings on the many dogmas, the true tenets of our church, as passed on by the apostles.
In the sixth century, some bishops would later convene in the town of Braga, Spain, which is now located in Portugal. Priscian, a founder of Manichaeanism, had helped to spread the errors of Manichaeanism throughout Spain, France, and northern Italy. At this synod, both Manichaeanism and the Priscillianists, who had been promoting these heresies, were condemned. Then, in the 7th century, the 11th Council of Toledo convened and defined the Creed on the Holy Trinity. This doctrine, which was read at the Council on November 7, 675, was based on only one of the many treatises written by St. Augustine on the treasures of the Church. It and the endless other documents in defense of the Church would earn him the titles of Early Father and Doctor of the Church.
In the 13th century, we would see Manichaeanism cropping up its ugly head once again, only now under a new name. In response to, in 1215, Innocent III would convene the Fourth Lateran Council, condemning the heresy of Albigensianism, which was simply Manichaeanism disguised as a new snake that had slithered out from under a rock. The church is under attack in the 15th century. The Council of Florence condemns Manichaeanism with this possession of faith, which clearly states, this profession of faith, which clearly states the church's teachings on creation.
The Holy Roman Church firmly believes, professes, and preaches that the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is the creator of all things visible and invisible. When God willed in his goodness, he created all creatures, both spiritual and corporeal. These creatures are good because they were made by the supreme good, but they are changeable because they were made from nothing. The church asserts that there is no such thing as a nature of evil because every nature, insofar as it is a nature, is good. It professes that one and the same God is the author of the Old and the New Testament, that it is the law of the prophets and of the gospel because the holy men of both testaments have spoken under the inspiration of the same Holy Spirit. It accepts and reveres their books as here listed, referring to the canon of books which followed.
As we have said countless times before, when heresies crop up, the church defines a truth, a dogma which it has believed in from the very beginning of the church. As God, through the death of his Son, brought eternal life to all who seek him, so the crucifixion of our church through heresies lodged against her has defined the priceless treasures she has in store for all who believe in her and in her founder, Jesus Christ. Jesus has a wonderful life for you on earth and in his heavenly kingdom. Open your heart and mind. Jesus is standing before you, waiting to enter.
Jesus said, I no longer speak of you as slaves, for a slave does not know what his master is about. Instead, I call you friends, since I have made known to you all that I heard from my Father. When he comes, the Paraclete, however, being the Spirit of truth, he will guide you to all truth. He will not speak on his own, but will speak only what he hears and will announce to you the things to come. Simon, Simon, remember that Satan has asked for you to sift you all like wheat, but I have prayed for you that your faith may never fail. You, in turn, must strengthen your brothers. And this, my brothers, is the word of the Lord.
We love you. May the Lord bless you, protect you, guide you, and strengthen you. See you next week. Thank you, family, for watching. This is just one of over 200 books and videos available here at Journeys of Faith.
Now, these are perfect tools for evangelization, and give them as gifts for birthdays, confirmations, First Holy Communion. Anytime you think of a gift, give one of these tools of evangelization. Write us at the address on our screen, or call us in the United States at 1-800-633-